this morning. Welcome, welcome. Also, welcome back to our travelers. Dave and Tammy are back with us, fresh out of Florida. You know the seashell you always put in your ear and you can hear the ocean, and you can stand close to them, you can still hear the ocean. They're fresh back from that, so we're glad for them to be back with us and the safe journey they had. We're also very, very thankful that Aaron Steele is back with us today, just back from Haiti. God bless you, Aaron, for your courage and just for your willingness to serve the Lord. If you have a chance to ask him about that trip, he has lots to say about it. So just thank God he is back with us also. And it's good to have you back, Aaron. Do want to remind everybody, please take the time to tear off the tab on your bulletin. Let us know if you have any praise or prayer requests. And just drop that in the offering plate when it comes by. We want to pray together as a church family and celebrate those praises. So take the time to do that. Also, we do practice open communion here at Southwest. So if you're a baptized believer of Jesus Christ as the Son of the living God, then we ask you to take part in that communion time just a little bit later on in our service. Let's open the word of prayer. Jesus, we just thank you for this glorious day, for the time that we can come together just to praise you, to lift our voices to you, to open our hearts up to you, just to receive your word and the Holy Spirit. And thank you for that, Jesus, and pray that the Spirit would just guide, guard, and direct our lives. And we just want to give you praise, honor, and glory this day. And our prayer is that the hearts are touched and lives are changed, and that your kingdom is glorified. Amen. Mm-hmm. Scripture this morning comes from Ephesians 3, verses 14 through 19. This is where Paul, this is written about 60 A.D., and Paul's in prison in Rome. And you can imagine, I mean, the conditions that he must have endured in a Roman prison in 60 A.D. And all he had was love for Christ, unfailing love for Christ. So he wrote this. This was to the church of Ephesus. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, for whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and how long and how high and how deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Won't you stand as we sing this morning?
I'll never.
We've come to our prayer time this morning. Several items on the prayer list. Please keep Adam Dedden's grandmother in prayer. Upcoming hip surgery on the 27th. Provide Moore's daughter Michelle just for continued health issues there. Continue to keep Rick Smith in prayer as he goes through his cancer treatments, and Tracy and the family, just lift them up. Southern Illinois Christian Service Camp, we have some of our youth down there, and we'll have throughout the rest of the summer, so just be in prayer about that. I know Randy was down there this past week and preached down there, and just lift up our youth that their hearts would be open and their lives would be changed there. For Edwina Wilkerson, not here today. I think she had to go visit to the ER room, and so still just wondering what's going on there, and so just lift her up in prayers to find out and get her back on her feet. For Jeff Reed, for the mission work in Tanzania that he is doing, and for Randy's upcoming trip there. Just want to be praying about that every day and lifting him up as he prepares for that. That's going to happen in early September, so continue to keep praying and prayer about that. As we mentioned in our opening praise for Aaron Steele, for being back with us and for the mission work he was able to do in Haiti. Praise God for that. Yeah. For Rhonda's mom, who is walking better and out of danger of losing her foot, so that's great news. Praise God for that. For Tommy Dare, continue to help my daughter Krista, for David Capps, Amanda Felty, who needs a liver transplant, Glenna Johnson, just continue to help there, for Evelyn Norton and Marilyn Cochran. Sue is with us again today, and pray we're still praising God that she's back with us after open heart surgeries. Just continue to lift her up and prayers for healing and strength. For Dave McCoy, who we've been praying about, just, you know, had a devastating stroke and literally unresponsive. And I understand now is able to at least walk a little bit, comprehends, laughing when he sees it and hears something funny. So praise God for that, for him. For Holly DeYoung and for Sue Keener, cancer patients, just continue prayer for them. Any others that I may have missed? For Jim Green, prayers for Jim, okay.
And George McCulley, I've not got an update on him, but they did put him on hospice this week. I've got an update in the last couple days. So.
Okay, George McCulley, now in hospice care.
My brother, Bobby Johnson, he's coming down from Springfield.
Okay, let's go. Oh, one more, Randy.
Pastor Kim wanted us to pray for her brother had a heart attack yesterday.
Who was that?
Patsy Kim. And her daughter has been induced, Keela. She's having some health issues with that pregnancy. She's got about 3 weeks left. They are inducing her. Go ahead.
Okay. Let's go a little bit. Jesus, we thank you for your great love, mercy, and grace that you pour out on us. Even though, Jesus, we're undeserving, you're still there for us each and every day with open arms. We thank you for the Holy Spirit that you send to us to guide and guard and direct our lives. And for your word to help us draw closer to you. We just pray as Randy brings us the message today, Lord, that our hearts and our minds be open just to receive you and our fellowship. Grow stronger. Lord, you know what they need. And so we just lift them up to you. And we know that you're a great physician. So for those that are in need of physical healing, we pray for that. For those who are in need of spiritual healing, we pray for that. Be the great comforter and redeemer and restorer. And we just give you praise and honor and glory. We pray for Jeff Reed in Tanzania, and we pray for Randy as he prepares to go there. Lord, let great things happen there. We know Jeff is doing great things and establishing the churches there. And we pray that Randy will just have safe journeys there and touch lives and touch hearts there. And Father, we just thank you for this church, for this congregation, for the love you pour out on us. In your name we pray.
proclaim through all the earth. Father, we pray your blessing and your might and your strength and your grace and love to be with all our mission efforts. We pray that you help them, that they might be better servants, ministers for your gospel message. Father, we ask that you bless this church. We ask that you bless our families. Help us to understand the joy of sacrifice and giving back to our Lord, our Maker, our Creator, our Savior, Jesus Christ. In his name I pray. Amen.
up the lights?
They are up.
Are the lights up? I don't know. You know, this morning is one of those mornings that I am tired. And I keep thinking, are the lights on in here? Because you guys feel that way? You're ever so busy and fogged, your mic's foggy and all of that. There's so many things going on. This morning, we're talking about entering the rest. We're not talking about entering the rest of sleepiness. I've been a little sleep deprived this week. There was one span of 3 days where I slept about 6 hours. Not good. It's not really necessarily something to brag about. And yet our society will tell you that that's the way we're supposed to be, that we're supposed to be going so fast, so long. That's not necessarily true. A large part of what God teaches us in His Word is to slow down, stop, and enter that rest. You guys are here this day to enter that rest, to meditate and to ponder upon the Lord, to think about it. This last week I was at church camp and working with junior high kids, and one of the lessons that we talked about in my group was meditate. What does it mean to meditate? What does it mean to stop and think? What does it mean to ponder on a verse or a word of God throughout the day? And so one of the verses that I had read this last week and was studying my own devotional time was Malachi chapter 1, verse 10. And literally, that verse is written to the priests that were in charge of the God's temple and leading the country. And what the verse actually said is this: "Oh, that one of you would shut the temple doors so that you would not light your useless fires on my altars. I am not pleased with you, says the Lord Almighty, and I will not accept any offering from your hands." Wow. That's kind of a kick in the pants, isn't it? "Oh, that one of you would shut the church doors, that you would not come in and sing useless songs, because I am not pleased with you, says the Lord God Almighty." How would you feel if you heard something like that? Or if that's what God would say to His people? Do you ever wonder if God wants to say that to His church? Do you ever wonder in our culture where we're so caught up in everything that we walk into places of worship, we participate in them, and we go out and live whatever lives we want? Do you ever think maybe God feels that way? You see, to meditate on that is to not just say, "Well, that's them, and this is me. We're good, they're bad, I don't know what they were thinking." So often we read the Bible, and we read the Bible as, "Well, I don't know what those people's problems was." Today we're going to be looking at part of that history lesson of when God's people went out of Egypt into the wilderness and they wandered for 40 years. Why did they get it? You know, if I'd been one of those people in the million, I certainly would have understood and I would have stood against the million. Wouldn't have you? Probably not. We tend to go along with the crowd. We tend to take everything on TV or what's happening in our society and we tend to fall right into line with it. When we have issues of materialism, money, sexuality, all these things in our culture that are so rampant, the church is absolutely different. There's nobody here today that deals with any of those problems, right? And yet so often the church looks just identical to what's happening in culture. That, my friends, is not what God has established. Amen.
God has established the truth of His Word, and He wants us to ponder that Word, to meditate on it, to take it in and to allow it to change every aspect of our life so that we don't see things the way everybody else sees it. Today, as we read through entering the rest, that's the rest I'm talking about. You have come into this place this day from whatever place you come to center your mind and your heart, to fix your eyes upon Christ, and to live lives that are extraordinary. Not just what everybody else is doing around us, but extraordinary in Jesus Christ. So I want you to get out your Bibles. If you don't have a Bible, there are ones in the pews. If you got your phone or device, I want it locked on to the Bible app and to the notes and what we're studying here, not to text messaging or anything of that nature. Hebrews chapter 4.
We're going to start reading along, following from what we've been studying over the last few weeks. Verse 1. And again, we're catching where this history lesson is actually to Christian Jews that are thinking about turning back in their faith to Judaism because it's what they understand instead of living the Christian life. And so often we do that as well. We hear Christ and then we want to turn back to our own ways of living. God calls us from that. Verse 1. Therefore, since the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us be careful that none of you be found to have fallen short of it. For we also have had the gospel preached to us, just as they did, but the message they heard was of no value to them, because those who heard it did not combine it with faith. Now we who have believed entered that rest just as God has said. The writer is saying to these people, these Jewish people that have become Christian, listen, just as our forefathers, just as our ancestors had the promise of God preached to them and had heard the truth of who God was, they had seen the great miracles when they left Egypt, the great Exodus, and went into the promised land. They had all these promises of God, and yet what did they miss? They literally saw these towers of fire leading them. They seen the Red Sea open up. They had went into the wilderness, but yet somewhere along the line they missed something. What does it say in these verses? What did they miss? Faith. They did not combine it with faith. And you know, we so often ask this question, what is faith? Faith is, in my opinion, it's life. And what I mean by that is, faith is, when you sit down and eat a meal, you eat it to the glory of God. Faith is, when you sit down to pay your bills, you pay them to the glory of God. I've heard it often said. If you want to know who's a true Christian in this house today, all you have to do is look at their checkbook. You know, some of the main topics that Jesus talked about in his life here on earth was money, sex, and what you eat. Why in the world would the Son of God spend time talking about those things? He should be talking about spiritual matters. What do you think spiritual matters are? It's the way we live our life in Christ. It's every aspect of life. It's just not a Sunday morning experience where we come in, listen to somebody preach, listen to some song, sing along, put a little money in the offering, and then that takes care of everything for the week, and next week we'll come back and do the same thing. Spirituality, faith, relationship in Christ is a day in, day out walk. It's the way I drive in the car. It's the way I treat my kids. It's the way we participate when we go to school, or the way that we behave when we're at work, the way that we respond when somebody cuts us off in traffic, the things that come out of our mouths when we slam our thumb with a hammer. Faith, all consistent. This is what God is talking about. Entering into that rest that comes in a relationship with Jesus Christ, and not just a practice religion. This last week, one of the things we talked about was, does anybody here have any idea how many registered or acknowledged religions there are in our world today? Anybody have a guess?
Some of you may know.
If you already heard it in class, we'll say it. Anybody else? You know? Over 4,000. Over 4,000 different religions that are recognized or recorded in the books, as they say. Over 4,000. And do you know out of those 4,000 how many are heavily persecuted? You might have an argument for a few, but it's a very small few, and there's only one that has been persistently persecuted through all time. And guess what that is? What you're sitting in right now. Now, you guys sitting here, Christians, Christianity, maybe you don't feel that much. But probably the vast majority of you sitting here don't realize that there are more martyrs in Christianity today than has ever been. That more people are dying for their faith because they live for Jesus than at any time in history. How come the media doesn't show us that? And why would it be that Christianity has been that one at the top that's always been persecuted and goes through persecution? Which one do you think the devil cares about? The one that's true and right. If all the others aren't on track and don't follow after God, then why would he care? That's what he wants. So
So it makes sense that if there's one true one, that he would be the one that gets picked on, persecuted, mistreated. God has said, so I declare on oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. What is the context of that? They weren't going to enter the promised land. We see in 40 years that whole generation dies off. Those people did not enter into the promised land with Joshua. What is God telling us? We won't enter if we don't combine it with faith. It's not our holiness that takes us into the promised land. It's the promise of Jesus Christ that carries us into the promised land. It's our reliance in Him and that relationship. And yet His work has been finished since creation of the world. So this history lesson gets a bit broader. Verse 4, for somewhere He has spoken about the seventh day in His word. And on the seventh day God rested from all His work. And again in the passage above He said, they shall never enter my rest. The writer does a very good job of explaining the whole history of the nation. Basically putting it this way. When God created the earth, what did He do on the seventh day? He rested from all His work because He was so tired. God had worked so hard putting the earth together and making all the animals and all the peoples. It was a lot of work, and so He was tired. Is that what it's talking about? Have any of you ever read Genesis and thought, Jesus, they must have been worn out from all that hard work? That's never been my impression. When I read that God rested from His work, I read that He looked back and was in glory of the great work. That He rested and took it all in, the relationship, the love, and everything that went into the perfection of what He had created. Again, when we talk about entering the rest, when you talk about entering the rest, when you come into church this day, when you join together with other believers in Christ, we come to enter the rest. Peace. And again, I know sometimes people may think that I'm not the most lovey-dovey of fellas. Because when I come into this house, I'm not so terribly concerned about the way y'all feel this day. I'm not really all that terribly concerned about all your circumstances or how bad your week's been. Now, I do care, but what I care more about is Christ in the center of it. Because I can tell you this, just because you're in this house today and you know Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior, things aren't going to be rosy tomorrow. They might stink, and it might get real bad. But if Jesus Christ is at the center, there is a promise and a hope of eternal life, not only in the future, but right now. So no matter what the circumstance or situation we walk into, Jesus is Lord. So when I say I'm not that terribly concerned about your circumstance or situation, I'm concerned about the truth to which you hold to. Because that truth is what will guide you. You want to know why so many of your neighbors and friends and college kids and people are growing up and they're letting go of the church and they're letting go of faith? It's because they never have the center right. Jesus has got to be everything to us in this house. It goes on, verse 6. It still remains that some will enter that rest, and those who formerly had the gospel preached to them did not go in because of their disobedience. Therefore, God again set a certain day, calling it today, when a long time later He spoke through David, as was said before, today if you hear His voice, do not harden your hearts. Goes on, for if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken later about another day. He's going back and he's tying the two history lessons together, the whole definition of that word today. We're looking forward to the day when Jesus Christ returns. When all this is over, when all the fogginess of mind and all the busyness of life and all the terrible things of life and all the physical pains of life and all the suffering of sin and all the stuff that happens and all the persecution happening, someday that will all come to an end. And I think it could be very well this day. That's one of those definitions of today, entering the rest of eternal salvation, entering the rest and seeing the fruition of that. But today, that the history was of the promise of when they entered into the promised land, some of those people didn't enter because they lacked the faith.
some of us may not enter. Listen, some of you may not enter that day, the day that has been called today, because of faith. And what do I mean by that? I'll ask the question, and you in this house, a lot of you already know, but on that scale from 1 to 10, how righteous do you feel this morning entering into this church building here at Southwest Christian Church? How righteous you feel?
On my own.
I hear a few tens. Man, these people are arrogant. How about the rest of y'all? Okay, we got an eight. You know, we base it on our feelings about our actions and the things we've done this week. A lot of us will say, maybe 0, 1, 2. If we're feeling pretty confident today, maybe 5. Those that have answered in this house of 10, they know the rest of the question, because the question goes on to say, on the scale of 1 to 10, how righteous do you believe Jesus Christ is today? He's an absolute perfection. 10. He's above the charts, right? We understand that. But in God, what the scripture teaches, the gospel gives us, it says that our righteousness is not found in and of ourselves. Our righteousness is in Jesus. So it's time for us to wake up and live in the promise of what God has taught us. Jesus is a 10. My righteousness is in Him. So often I live on the bottom side looking up, but I should be looking from the top looking down. When I start my day on Monday mornings, I should be saying, I am a servant of the Most High God. What will God plan today? Instead of waking up and feeling like I'm on the bottom of a cesspool. That is not what we are taught in the scriptures. We are His and He is mine. I am entering His rest this day. I am relying myself to Him again today. I am believing in Jesus Christ for everything I have tomorrow. You know, I have mentioned, 1 month from today, I fly out on the greatest adventure I've probably ever taken in my life. I've never flown more than 3 hours, and it's always been across land. I'm going to be on a plane for 23 hours one way. And I'm going to be crossing over an ocean. But here's the thought I give you this day. If my rest is in God, and God has appointed the time for each of you and I to visually, physically see Him again, then is God going to be there a month from today? Same as He is right now. So what's there to worry about? How many of you sit in these pews and you're worried about something else? You're not paying attention to what I'm talking about. Wake up! Right now. What are you thinking about? Why is it? Because you're worrying about something else instead of centering and focusing yourself in Christ. Paul was trying to tell people here, wake up. It's kind of funny because he's saying entering the rest, and yet he's saying wake up. Don't do what they did. Follow after Jesus with all your heart. He said at the beginning of this, you people should be the ones leading and teaching. Yet so often you're the babies. How often do you walk into church and you feel like a baby? Maybe you feel like you don't know your Bibles very well. Maybe you feel like you don't know what to say when somebody asks about Jesus or is having problems. Wake up. Get into the Word. Read it every day. Pray to God with everything you've got for those neighbors and friends. Cry it out to the one that hears and changes, that takes the scales away from people's eyes. It is time for us to realize we are 10. Not that we're arrogant people, we're humble people. Believing the truth of God's Word, knowing that we have been purchased with the blood of Jesus Christ for something greater. Look at what it says in this next part. These next two verses are verses that when I first read them as a Christian man that truly believed in Jesus Christ, they cut me to the core. And what I mean by the core is, when everything else is shaken down, when you go through the absolute worst of days, when you get that worst news, when everything is stripped away, what is at the core of you? If you want to know what somebody really believes, watch them on that day when they get the report. Watch them in the midst of the accident. Watch them in the midst of a lost job. Watch them in the midst of terrible news. You'll see what's at their core. Verse 12 and 13, for the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Kind of a picture here. What's it talking about? It's talking about a sword, a weapon, something used in war. Literally, those people would have been very familiar with it. They've probably seen it. They may have seen it in the marketplace or things like that. But we're talking about a weapon that can literally slash right through the middle of things. No matter what baggage you bring. Friday when I was picking up Aaron from the Atlanta airport, the international airport, I saw so much baggage go through that place. And everybody had their own particular baggage. Some of them had fancy ones that they rolled around on wheels. Others had it strapped over the shoulders. But everybody had baggage. Not so much difference than what we got sitting here today, right? All of you have baggage. You have stories. You have failures. You have struggles you're going through right now. You have all the stuff that you brought with you into this place. Y'all look so great. I look out and I think you're smiling. Most of you are awake, I think. You're paying attention. But in the midst of us, in the midst of me, it's not always so good. And we're not always the stand-up Christian men and women we should be. We all have regrets in this house, or shame, or guilt, and all this stuff, that baggage we bring in. But tell you this, no matter how pretty we look or how well we smile this morning, God cuts straight to the core of it. Right to the core of it. So you guys know this very well about me, probably. I'm not interested in just meeting together to have a good time in the fellowship. I mean, I like it. Sometimes I say things kind of a little straight. I like everybody. I love you guys. I love being with you. But what I'm interested in joining here is to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ and to hold firmly to the truth of His Word. In spite of what's happening around us, in spite of what we see on TV, in spite of what any TV evangelist or anybody else may say, God's Word is the core and the direction. And so this is what's got to be at the core of us. Verse 13. Nothing in all the creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of Him to whom we must give an account. Think about it. God sees it all. It's all laid bare. Every word, every thought, every intention, everything we've ever done. You know, it's like if we took just one of you. Anybody want to be an example today? You might be a little nervous when I'm talking about here. If you wanted to be an example, I'll take Aaron, since we've mentioned his name a few times. Aaron Steele. He's my son. He can't refuse. If we put on the screens up here today everything that Aaron has said, thought, done, paid money for, what he's looked at, done with his phone this week, what he's done with his friends this week, where he's been. It's actually been pretty good because he's been in Haiti all week and he's been focused in the Word of God. But think of that as you, and we put you on the screen this day. Would any of you be embarrassed? Would there be things that have happened this week or things you said that you're like, oh, I don't want my church family to know I said that, or that I read that, or that I watched that, or that I participated in that? Or these things happen. Anybody? God tells us, listen, my friends, there's nothing that you're doing that you can hide from me. There's no place that you can go that you can be apart from me. I see you men and women for what you really are sitting here this day. And some of you in your mind say, oh my Lord. If that be true, then what am I sitting here for? I am so embarrassed before you, God. But don't see it that way. I mean, yes, we should be ashamed of the sin of our life. We should reject that sin. But what I'm telling you is this, is that Jesus, God, He understands and He knows exactly who you are sitting in these pews today, and He loves you absolutely, purely, wholly. Completely. That's awesome. But there is a response to that love. And there is a part of us that has to say, Lord God, here I am. Examine me, see me, and see what needs to change. Because I want to worship you.
I want to meditate on you. I want to ponder you. I want to enter your rest.
The beauty of what we read in the last part, verse 14 through 16, is Jesus is not just some high priest or preacher that stands up in a pulpit and hollers at you and makes you feel terrible and you walk out of this place. If you ever feel that way with me, maybe you don't have to shake your heads yes or no. I don't want you to feel that way. I do want to wake you up. And I don't want to just stand up here and smile and say, oh, you people, all you got to do is put your money in those offering plates and just praise the Lord and say happy thoughts, and it'll come back around in a big old circle to you. And God will just bless you so richly and abundantly, you'll all have new cars by next year. That's hogwash Christianity. And I pray for you every single day. And I want a family that's going to stand together and pray together and live by the truth of God's word. And if there's stuff we read in the Bible that hurts our feelings, then guess what? Our feelings need to be heard. We got to wake up. There is so much lost out there. So much has been stolen. So much has been hurt. Our children are suffering and our neighbors are dying. And they need the truth of who Jesus Christ is. So we have to come, as we read in Psalm 139 at the end of that Psalm. Psalm 139, one of these great passages. And in the inmost being, God knew us when we were being woven together. He knows even before our words on our tongue. If we go to the other side of the sea, He is there. Even in the midst of the darkness is as light to Him, because God is there and He sees it all. And He knows me. He knows me better than I know myself. But the very last two verses of that psalm says, after this guy wrote about how great God knows him, he says, oh God, know me. Search me. See if there's any waywardness in me. Show me what I need to change. Did the guy not just listen to what he wrote? He just said God absolutely knows everything about me. But what the difference is, the end of the psalm is, I'm here willing, Lord. So all of you here this day, you probably realize, and you really do know, that God sees you for what you are here in these pews today. You know it. There probably isn't one of you sitting here thinking that you're snowing God, or that you're somehow fooling Him, or you may think you're fooling us, but you're not fooling God. The difference is, for you and I sitting here this day, worshiping the Lord God Almighty, is to say, here I am, God. And I know I've got these issues. And I know I have these problems. I lay before you here at this altar today. I lay my life before you, God, and I want to be your servant, God. Change me. Jesus, change me. Verse 14 through 16. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. He's been there. He was in heaven. He was there at creation. He has lived in perfection, and He came here. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Jesus isn't just looking down on us, pointing His finger. John 3:16 is a great passage, but everybody forgets verse 17. 16 says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish but have eternal life. That's the story of who Jesus is. But the verse 17 says, for God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world. You know, we get this mixed idea and these ideas of theology and our ideology in our mind, that we have these preachers and people that are living up on this pedestal, and they're all pointing at us and telling us how terrible we are, and if we don't get over our terribleness, then we're all going to burn in rotten hell. Well, the truth of the matter is this. We're all on the same playing field. You sitting there and me standing in the pulpit, we're the same people. I've got sin, you've got sin, we all got sin. And so does everybody else outside these walls. The only difference and the only separation that will ever be is my sin and your sin covered by the blood of Jesus Christ. And this day, as I know many of you, I profess it. I confess. I believe that Jesus Christ
the Son of the living God, and I accept him as my Lord and Savior, and I will live my life for him. It's all I can do. It's all I know how to do. We have to accept him, because he is our great high priest. He's not someone that's just looking down on us. He's someone that's with us. And when I accepted Jesus Christ and I was baptized in him and I lived my life for him, he's now in me. And I am his and he is mine. So this morning, I want to tell you, if your mind's all blurred, you're looking at life and you're worried about tomorrow, if you've been sitting through most of this sermon today and you've been worrying about something else, let me tell you, you need Jesus. And I'm not talking about Sunday morning Jesus in a one-hour segment Jesus. I'm talking about an everyday moment of your life Jesus that walks with you and talks with you and you share intimate relationship. I want you to be a people that hunger and thirst for the Word of God. I want you to be a people that confess your sins and don't let anything be held back. I want you to be a people that yield every aspect of your life to Him. And I want you to be a people that thank God for the filling of the Holy Spirit that's in you. Know who you are. You are not just beaten down walking on mats. You are not just human. I get so sick of hearing people say, well, I'm only human. That's from Satan. I am a child of the Most High God. Are you a child of the Most High God? Are you an ambassador of Jesus Christ? Do you belong to the kingdom of heaven and you're only here temporarily? That's what I am. Are you a part of that? This is what Paul was trying to tell these Jewish Christians. Don't turn back. Go straight ahead. I'm here to tell you this morning. Get up, people. Wake up. Take life by the horns. Do what you've been called to do. Study God's Word. If you don't know what to say to your neighbor about Jesus and what God's Word would say, well, guess what? Don't come ask me. Not a bad idea. But what I'm saying is, read the Bible. There's a reading plan in your bulletin every single week. There's absolutely no reason anybody in this house should not read the Bible. Well, I can't see it. Tell him what to do, Jim.
Listen to it.
Listen to it. He does it every single day. He can't see it too well. But he listens to it every single day. I know people that are deaf and blind, but they feel it with their fingers. So what's your excuse? It's a hunger. And if you don't have the hunger, which I at times have not had that hunger,
then you pray for the hunger.
Because you know how hunger feels when you haven't ate food. That's the way God tells us to hunger about the truth of His Word. I want to pray over you, and then I want to say just a couple more words before our praise team comes up. Father God, as we come here this day, we don't come just to sit back and watch or just sit back and not be a part. We come to worship you, to serve you, to love you. Lord, we do not want to be like so many in the scriptures that are talked about, and so many through history, so many of our relatives and family that have heard about you but have not surrendered to you. We want to be men and women that surrender in faith and hope and love to the Almighty Jesus Christ. Lord, we want to be your servants. Show us, help us to do that. Create in us a hunger. Help us to love you more, to worship you with everything we have. We're desperate, God. We see so many people hurting and struggling around us, and we don't know what to do. But you are the one, you have the truth, and you are the way. So God, we're here. Search us. Reveal in us sins that need to be confessed. Help us to yearn for you and your love. Lord, I pray right now for those that need to confess you as Jesus Christ, to give them the strength and the faith to do that here and now. To come before you and confess your name, to believe and to be baptized in you, Jesus. Lord, for those that have, I pray for your strength, power to be upon them. Because we thank you that you, Holy Spirit, live in us. Lord, reveal to us now and as we go out from here who we are and who we belong to you.
you, Jesus Christ.
It's in your almighty name that we ask and pray these things.
Amen.
As our praise team comes up here this morning, I'm going to ask you to stand up. If there is something that has struck a chord in you, the Spirit's been working on your heart, maybe to pray about something here at the altar, I want to encourage you to do that. Step out of faith, walk forward and do that. There is something about physically stepping out and doing what God has asked you that really changes in you. If you haven't confessed Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, that's absolutely the first thing you need to do, is to confess His name, to believe in Him as Lord, and to surrender your life to Him. So I want to encourage you to do that as well. So would you please see Him as the praise team leads you?
But
I want to keep growing in the Lord, and I want it to be a public statement.